You're listening to the audio production of Startup Money Made Easy, the Inc. guide to every financial question about starting, running, and growing your business by Maria Aspan, published by HarperCollins Leadership and read by Hayley Cresswell.
Introduction. Ultimately, you know you'll make mistakes. The key is trying to minimize the impact and learn from them. Venus Williams, tennis star and founder and CEO of 11 by Venus. I often describe finance as the broccoli of running a business. It's good for you, full of nutritional necessities to sustain life, but it's all too often something completely unappealing, overwhelmingly strong, or boiled down to something limp and useless. During 4 years spent overseeing the money coverage at Inc., I've tried to turn startup finance into the fun, delicious broccoli, the financial vegetable sautéed with lots of extra virgin olive oil and red pepper flakes and showers of chopped garlic, the sort of broccoli you might go to a restaurant just to order, the sort of thing you look forward to reading about and spending time thinking about. As the leafy green vegetable of almost any project, money is essential to starting, running, and expanding a business. It's something that all successful entrepreneurs have had to deal with, and that they've disliked intensely at some point in their company's journey from idea to empire. It's something that has caused each successful founder to make mistakes, many, many mistakes, over the course of that journey. Just ask Venus Williams, a woman who knows a thing or two about overcoming setbacks. The Wimbledon champion, U.S. Open champion, and Olympic gold medalist spends her not very copious spare time running her startup, sportswear and athleisure maker 11 by Venus. In her role as founder and CEO, Williams has faced more than sports injuries and on-court rivalries. She's overcome the bankruptcy of her retail partner and costly manufacturing mistakes. And she managed to recover, and then some, turning her business around so that it tripled sales in 2016. "I always dreamed of being an entrepreneur," Williams told Inc. in 2017. "That was one of my lifelong goals." If you're listening to this book, that dream probably sounds familiar, as will the mistakes that Williams made with money, and that many other successful and prominent entrepreneurs, including Mark Cuban, Bobbi Brown, Jack Ma, Christina Tosi, and Daymond John, all surmounted as they built their businesses. This book will share their stories, and those of many other startup founders, as it walks you through the biggest money questions you'll face about your business. How much money do you need to start something new? How should you raise the necessary funds, whether from banks or venture capitalists or family and friends? What financial hurdles might you encounter after your business starts to expand? And maybe even someday, how can you sell or retire from your business and enjoy everything that your hard work created? The answers lie within this guide, along with lots of stories and advice from today's most successful entrepreneurs. If you're looking for some inspiration and a whole lot of commiseration, you'll find plenty in this book. 1. Starting from scratch. When I was 22 years old, a guy who owned a little bodega in my neighborhood told me, "If you really want to start a company, you better dig under your couch for a couple of extra dollars, stop going out to dinner 4 times a month, trade in your car for a cheaper one, and raise that $40,000 or $30,000, if you can, by yourself." Daymond John, Shark Tank investor and FUBU founder. You want to start a business. You've got the idea, you're ready to hustle, but how much money do you need to launch your startup? 10 years ago, the average cost of starting a small business was $31,150, according to one study. That seems laughably large today. While some businesses still require lots of money to get off the ground, at Inc., we regularly hear from founders of fast-growing companies who started their businesses for hundreds, not thousands, of dollars. Today, a smart entrepreneur with a website can start making in 6 months what we were making after 6 years. says Bert Jacobs, co-founder of the apparel company Life is Good. Technology's rapid advance is bringing down many startup costs, as Jacobs points out. He and his brother John launched the first iteration of their company in 1989 with $200 borrowed from another brother, Alan. The early days were scrappy, to say the least, as Jacobs told Inc.'s Lee Buchanan. "We would have used that technology if we'd had it. Instead, we spent years building a company with employees we met at pickup basketball games, customers we joked with in the streets while keeping one eye peeled for the beat cop, and advice from retailers up and down the East Coast whom we dropped in on. It may not have been the most effective process. Definitely, it wasn't the most efficient. But a lot of our company's values came out of that early need to do things cheap and in person." Life is Good now sells $100 million worth of apparel every year. And there are parts of Jacob's experience, especially the grit and patience, that remain relevant today. If you're dreaming of starting a business that could someday rival his success, you don't necessarily have to spend money in the same ways. Entrepreneurs who have started their companies more recently agree that the technology of today, well, rocks. It's, oh my God, 1,000% easier now to go out and set up your own thing. Matthew Schwab, co-founder and president of San Francisco flower delivery startup Bloom Mat, told me in 2016. Schwab set up his company using Stripe, the payment processing platform that makes it easier for many online businesses to start selling goods or services. And Stripe is just one part of the large ecosystem of tech services that exist to help you get your startup off the ground cheaply and quickly. What we at Inc. call the Instant Startup Kit. Websites, billing, payment processing, cloud computing, communications, funding, all have been made simpler by the likes of Squarespace, Slack, Kickstarter, Dropbox, Amazon's ubiquitous web services division, and PayPal. In the past 10 years, these building blocks have greatly reduced the time and cost involved to start a business, especially high-tech ones. Thanks to the emergence of the internet, open-source software, cloud computing, and other trends, some experts estimate tech-reliant ideas that would have cost $5 million to set up a decade ago can be done for under $50,000 today, according to a 2014 paper from the National Bureau of Economic Research. Good news! You probably don't need $5 million to start your business. You might not need $50,000 or $30,000. In fact, you might not even need half of that. In 2014, 49% of Inc. 500 founders responding to our annual CEO survey said they used under $5,000 to launch their businesses. The next biggest group, 15%, said they needed between $10,000 and $50,000. The amount of money you need will vary depending on your answers to the following questions. What kind of business do you want to start? How many people do you need to run your startup? Where are you starting your business, and how much space do you need? How quickly do you need to get your product or service to market? How long can you afford to live without a salary? Let's go through each of these questions. What kind of business do you want to start? This is the most fundamental factor in determining the kind of money you'll need up front. What are you selling, and is it a product or a service? Product-based businesses tend to be more expensive to initiate. If you're making t-shirts or baking cupcakes or designing mobile apps, you'll need the raw materials to create your product, the equipment for the production, the people to perform the manufacturing or baking or coding, and the space to do the work. Planning on doing it all yourself, at least at the start? Remember that you'll also need to spend time actually selling your product and marketing it so you'll have customers interested in buying it. Melissa Beniche, co-founder of mini cupcake company Baked by Melissa, got her start during a dark time. The day she was fired from her job as a media planner in 2008, Beniche went home and baked 200 cupcakes. She gave them away to friends to bring into their offices, which piqued caterers' interest. Still, the early days were full of self-doubt and imposter syndrome. Binichet told me, "After I was fired from my advertising job, I worked out of my apartment for 7 months by myself. I'd cold call catering companies and say, 'Hi, this is Melissa from Baked by Melissa. I'd like to bring you a free tasting of my cupcakes.' I remember crying to my brother, 'Who the hell do I think I am? Melissa of Baked by Melissa?' I felt like a fraud." Within 7 years, Binichet was selling her cupcakes in 14 New York area stores and nationally online. Inc.com columnist Jason Albanese, co-founder and CEO of digital consultancy Centric Digital, describes the challenge for product-based startups as upfront product development costs, coupled with the risk of market acceptance. In other words, there's no real way of knowing whether or not the product you're investing in is going to succeed and offer any kind of substantial return. Service-based businesses are, in many ways, a lot easier and cheaper to launch, particularly if you already have industry expertise and contacts. If you're a lawyer or an accountant or a digital marketing expert, or have any other specialized business experience, you have the product, your expertise, and potentially the market. You can start selling your services on your own to people and companies that may be familiar with you and your work. You don't have to hire anyone else, at least at first. You don't necessarily have to spend more money on office space, as long as you can work out of your home. And ideally, you don't have to spend as much time marketing your services. The downside, Albanese points out, that service-based companies face more costs and complexity later on as they try to scale, since their growth depends on having more people. We'll address expansion costs in Chapter 6. How many people do you need to run your startup? As we discussed previously, if you're selling yourself and your services, you'll need less money up front than if you expect to hire others. For product-based businesses, you can do what you can on your own, and you can beg friends and family to help, but it's more likely that you'll soon need to pay for help. That doesn't necessarily mean bringing on full-time employees. You can also consider hiring consultants or part-time workers. An increasing number of online marketplaces provide one-off help with specific tasks, as well as remote help with recurring work. Freelancer and remote job sites include Upwork, all sorts of freelancers, Working Not Working, creative and design work, and Power to Fly, tech talent, much of it remote and looking for longer-term assignments, specializing in matching tech jobs with qualified women. If you're planning to start a business that requires full-time employees, your immediate expenses, beyond salaries and healthcare costs, may include other insurance, rent for your workspace, and retirement plans. There are less obvious costs, too, as we will discuss in a later chapter. Where are you starting your business, and how much space do you need? Can you work out of your home? Do you need office space or desks in a co-working space? And are you starting your business in an expensive, densely populated city, or in a place with lower real estate costs? Cities across the Midwest and in the growing tech hubs of Utah are some of the best places to start a business, due in part to their affordable real estate, according to annual rankings by personal finance website WalletHub. Meanwhile, the six most expensive cities for office space are all in California, as many a Silicon Valley founder knows, which has led to lots of competition for office space and some creative cost-saving strategies. One California-based startup, social media analytics firm Buffer, tried to save some rent in 2015 by closing its San Francisco office, since too few employees were using it, Inc.'s Victoria Finkel reports. Instead, the startup covers co-working memberships for those who want them, an estimated 15 to 20% of the startup's then staff of 64 people. How quickly do you need to get your product or service to market? Do you have a brilliant idea to solve an immediate problem, And will customers still buy your product if you spend months or years developing it? In the meantime, how many competitors will introduce a version of your idea? If speed is of the essence, you may need outside money, and a lot of it, to quickly develop and start selling your product.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.